Okay, welcome to today's webinar. My name is Dominic from LeanIX. Before we start with part two of our GraphQL webinar series, I'd like to clarify two housekeeping tasks. One, you will have time to ask questions after the presentation. And two, we will of course send you the recording just after the presentation. So, without further ado, welcome to part two of our GraphQL webinar series. Part one covered the basics. Now it's time to go into detail. So I hope you are prepared. What do we have on today's agenda? We will do a really quick recap from part one, but in general, please refer to the recording of part one in case you have any questions on the basic. We will then do a deep dive. We will talk about filter, we will talk about paging, about patches, and about revisions. And you will learn to unleash the power of those. And then we will leave the GraphQL IDE and go into real scenarios for integrations. We will talk about embedding GraphQL in Swagger. We will talk about using it in curl and in Java. And finally, we'll do a concrete use case based on Python. So let's get started. Once again, the motivation to open an API with GraphQL and to bet on a modern technology is the way that using and embedding Linux is evolving. So you see from a single source of truth perspective on the web UI, on Excel upload and download, we already added out-of-the-box integrations and we will continue to add more in the future. But we see that the demand for both data input from IT management tools and data usage in modern reporting solutions is so much increasing that we want to give Linux users the chance to create their own integrations. And we are delighted that so many of you are already taking the chance. If you want to check some use cases, please refer to the recording of part one. As you might recall, there were just two basic concepts in GraphQL which you have to remember. We will talk about queries, and especially when we talk about filter, it will be the topic to get data out of Linux, to get subscription and tag out of Linux in every combined form. And then we will talk about mutations. Mutations is concept to create and update any data you find in Linux, like fact sheets, subscription tags, and so on. And concepts like patches and revisions are addressed for this. So again, it's always good to remember that when dealing with GraphQL, the GraphQL IDE directly in your Linux workspace is your best friend. You don't need to set up a development environment to get things started. You can work interactively directly on your workspace data just right from the admin area. You have auto-completion, you have predefine, you can formulate variables, and you have an inline documentations. So let's get started. We'll talk about filter and paging, which are query concept. Filter help you to know how to get your data in the way you want, while paging helps you to deal with large amount of data. And then we will talk about mutation concepts, like patches to make the different mutations in the way you want, and like revisions to deal with concurrent changes. So starting with filter, I will first walk you through some of the basic filters and then get more advanced. So for now, I use the all fact sheet query as illustration. The other queries you find in Linux are similar, like all tags or all subscriptions. For now, let's start with this and you will learn the basic concepts here. So you see all fact sheets has different filter variants and we will skip through the most important ones. So the easiest one for sure is to filter by ID. Given you have one or a list of fact sheet IDs at hand, which you know you can find, for example, in the Linux UL, but also in the table view when you want to deal with more than one fact sheet, you can just add those IDs at a filter and get the data precisely for those fact sheets. Similar, the concept of external ID is working. And with Pathfinder, we have a more generic concept of external IDs. In theory, you could have as many external IDs as you need to integrate with other systems. This is why you find a pass in the filter for external IDs. So this is an example based on our Signavio integration, where an application is tied to a Signavio glossary item, and you see that the pass is combined of the name of the external ID and then the external ID itself. To figure out the exact pass, just use the external ID in the results section of the query, and autocomplete will help you to get the exact formulation. Again, no surprise here. If you input the external ID, the fact sheet is occurring, and again, you can work with a list, which makes things nice if you want to work with other systems. Then, also a good approach is to work with exact display name. Why it's often convenient to work with an ID, because you feel that this is more precise for integrating systems. There are use cases where you have the exact name of the fact sheet and it works as expected. Be aware, however, that there are different ways to generate display names in Linux. So you can have a hierarchy, you can have release in Linux, and this filter will only return if the exact display name is matched. To get a bit more sophisticated, let's start with the topic of search. First, let's dive into quick search. And quick search is what you see typically in Linux on the top right. You just enter a couple of letters and you get direct suggestions from the inventory. We made this quick search open in the filter and it will give you the results as expected, but be aware this is optimized for performance, so we didn't include any descriptions or other topics here. If you want to query also descriptions, you should use the full text search instead. The full text search is what you can find, for example, embedded in the smart search, where you type text finance and you will get everything related to finance. So for example, this description has finance inside, where the display name has not, but still you obviously get it. So you can just use it as a criteria for the filter. And then there's a more powerful concept of emulating our filter facets. And this is really nice because you will learn in a second that essentially we will have an inline documentation of all these facets just right in your browsers. But first, let's start with the example. You see on the right-hand side a snippet of your filter facet in Linux. And let's say as a first step, we want to filter for applications. Cool, let's do this. Let's define an object facets filters. And let's integrate first facet key, which is factory types, and the key is application. Can have more than this, but let's do one. And you see that 345 applications are returned. Now, facet filters is actually an array, and you can have more than one filter in it. So let's just add another one, which is business criticality. You see at the right-hand side, we ticked mission critical, and the count decreases to 25. Repeating the similar things, you can also include relations. You see well application to user group, and you have a key. So you have the ID of the reference fact sheet. You can also have more than one ID here. Again, similar to what you know from the Linux UI. And as expected, the count is decreased to 6. And finally, you add, for example, a data quality facet, like you want to have only fact sheet without description, which is a built-in data quality facet, as you all know. You can also add it like this, the count decreases to 4. You see that this is really easy, but on the other hand, you have to know the precise keys and values. So where do I get this from? We have a pro tip here, and this is you can use the browser developer tools as reference for facet keys and values. If you don't know about your browser developer tools, check those two links for Chrome and for Microsoft browsers on the top right. They have similar concepts. In general, the browser developer tools helps you, for example, to get events client-side, but also to trigger network calls. And so they typically have a tab network, and you see that once you applied the query, you see there's a request to the server, and there are all the filters inside. So recalling, we had factory types, we had data quality, business criticality, and application to user group, and you find the very precise syntax here. So while you will see at the end that there are are examples in our documentations, it's always good to, in case of doubt, refer to your web UI as source of truth, because as you know, we are, have the ability to customize the data model, and it's not possible to document all of the facet keys we have or you have in your custom data model. So please, in case of doubt, either check out GraphQL or the browser developer tools. So this was great already, but let's dive one step further. Because right now, what we did, we queried for facet keys, like for applications, data quality. But what we did not do is to work more precisely with the queries. So one way to do this is you can create a subfilter. And this is really cool because this shows you the power of a Graph API and a Graph database beneath it. So what you can do is you can formulate the query, show all applications that uses an IT component of provider Microsoft. So this leverage the graph, it application is one fact sheet, IT component is another, provider as a second. You can think of creating another subfilter to jump through the inventory with this. And in a way, you find it in the UI as well. This is what you see as advanced filter in the filter facets. So you can include to the array of facet filters, you can include an argument called subfilter, and then another array of fact sheet facet filters opens, and it's the same, but just one level below. So no surprise on the result side, you find all applications that uses a Microsoft technology somewhere. But still, to go one step further, you want now to have only the Microsoft technology and leave out all the rest, because you see right now there's Dell and there's Oracle here, because right now you just queried all applications, full stop. So you can do this as well. And to do this, you have to go down to the relation in the result set, and the relation also take a filter. So at the relation, you can also say, only show me some of the relations. Like in this case, only show me the relations to the provider Microsoft. And you see what happened, you just get the result. Even on this level, you can steer really concretely what you want to see. And again, as elaborated in the first webinar, this will save you network time, and this will also save you developer time, because you can focus on the data this is in your context and leave out all the rest. So much for filter for now. We can go all night long, but I believe this gives you an overview. So let's head quickly for another concept, which is important if you deal with large amount of data in productive settings. Because we limited the number of fact sheets you can return with one call for obvious performance reasons, but we included a consistent paging to all queries. So you see in the result set of the query, you can include page info object and just say, I want this attribute has next page and end cursor. And in step two, you can see what this means. It will give you has next page true if there are more data, so you only queried the first two, and it will give you a cursor. And what you can then do is you can take precisely this cursor in the next call and again say, give me the first two, but after this cursor. And you can iterate and until has next page is false. Doesn't make any sense to do this obviously with a page size of 2, but a page size of 50 might be a good thing to pursue to leverage paging and deal with large amount of data. So let's move to the mutation side. I introduced briefly in the last part of the webinar that patches are required to update data. So what is a patch? Recalling, you can patch attributes. So you have an operator, you have a path and a value. And you can also patch relations. So you can again have an operator, a path and a value. You see that the syntax is slightly different, and I want to provide you a quick overview of the arguments you need to put here. So for pages, we support three operators. We support an add operator, which adds a new attribute or relation. We support a replace operator, which replaces obviously some existing. And we support a remove operator. For the parses, attributes behave slightly different than relations. For attributes, just put the name. For relations, you have to distinguish. For new relations, you have to work with this syntax, so just put new index, so new one, new two, new three for new relations. While if you have a relation, you need to put the existing relation. And the value also depends as well. We have a string, we have a JSON object, or we can work with arrays. So there are two steps, two points that you should take away on patches. So one is, please, if possible, include multiple patches in one API call. So you've seen patches is an array, and if you include multiple patches in one call, it will save you network, it will save you turnaround time, it will make things faster. And the other thing, while this concept of patches is fairly simple, again, the precise syntax when dealing with attributes, when with relations, with external IDs, might be a bit difficult. And again, please use the browser developer tools. You can navigate through the editing commands in Linux and just use it as a template. So finally, let's talk about revisions. And revisions has been a pain in the old version because they were simply not there. So given that you have the case that you want to make an update concurrently in the UI and via GraphQL. So what happens? You start to edit a fact sheet in the UI, and at the same time, somebody retrieves the fact sheet via GraphQL. He will get a revision, and it's 23. He will issue an update, and you see that the revision increased to 24. And now the conflict resolution is working as expected. When I save in the UI, I will get an error. Or rather, don't say error because the system is behaving correctly, I will get a warning saying, hey, there's a conflict. Somebody has been editing in the same time. So you should be expecting to see this, for example, as well, if you work with many users on similar data. And now you are up to choose. You have to choose whether you want to discard your changes because you feel that the changes of another person are more important, or you can save and override. Of course, in the later case, you will always have the audit trail available. But for dealing with the API, it's good practice to include the revisions in your calls. You can get them in your queries and include them in your mutations as well to make your mutations error-proof to work in a concurrent environment. So quick summary, we covered some important concepts, but now let's move on. Let's move beyond the inline IDE to see how to deal with GraphQL in the real world in production. I want to start with Swagger and curl. For those of you who don't know Swagger, I will give a really brief intro. But then I will quickly move to Java and to Python. Because the concepts you see in Java are typical for other programming languages like C#, while the concepts you see in Python are typical for other programming languages like JavaScript. So it gives you an overview about how easy it is to get started here. So starting with Swagger, and you know that you have in the tools area of the Linux workspace, you have Swagger docs available. So Swagger docs are for REST APIs, and actually if you call GraphQL outside from outside Linux, you use a REST API, and I'll show you in a second. But for now, please make sure to create an API token before opening Swagger because you will need it soon. So I open Swagger, and I insert my API token, press Explore. And for those of you who don't know Swagger yet, this is a great tool similar to GraphQL in some way that you can directly execute some calls. So you went through the authentication by providing your API token. And what now happened is you can execute REST calls, get result again without a dedicated development environment. And you see that in our Pathfinder REST API, there's a GraphQL endpoint. And we'll get to this in more depth. Because this GraphQL endpoint, it takes three variables as input. It takes a query as a string, and I'll show it. It takes variables, again, like the GraphQL tool that you can better structure your queries, and it also takes operation names that you can just name the query. I start with a really small example here to just have a query, and you might recognize the syntax. It's all fact sheets, it's fact sheet type application, edges node ID just returning the ID. And you see in the response area, no big surprise, you get the ID. What's interesting is you also get with Swagger the curl command. So if you want to use it from the command line, you get the curl command here as well to call GraphQL. Be aware that right now you see the header is taking care of the authorization. If you want to go into the depths of authentication of OOs, how this is solved, just check our developer hub. So same thing for mutation. You can just insert your mutation as a query. Be aware that you have to mask some hyphens here, and just use it as expected, the response as expected. So this is nice, but only to show you the mechanics behind it. Essentially, what we learn is that typically you don't want to call GraphQL from REST or from curl. What you typically do with APIs like a normal REST API. But for GraphQL, it's so easy to create a Java or a Python program, and let's just jump into this one. So Java, what's nice about Java is that we have an SDK available. So we use Maven, and we give you an SDK on Linux. What this SDK will do for you is it will handle the connection, so it will handle the authentication, and essentially it's just about typing those five lines to create an API client with the right base path. So please make sure to have your right domain here, token provider host, and with the API token, and then it's just it. Created an object which is get fact sheet by ID, gives a fact sheet ID and the result, and you can execute it. And similar, you can update fact sheet by a simple call. We'll get into the details of get fact sheet by ID and update fact sheet right now, but it's interesting, you have the link directly afterwards to check the entire source code here. So getting into the details, call GraphQL from Java and get the fact sheet by ID. What we did here, we created a base class GraphQL query, which just includes some standard JSON libraries and provide a method called execute query, which you can use. So you have a method execute, which is in public, and a method build that you implement. And you see, in this case, we have this fact sheet query. We just put it into fact sheet. We take care of the brackets here and allow the caller to include the return arguments. So you can leverage some advantages of the flexible GraphQL API by, for example, putting a return value like this, while on the other side, not having the hassle as a direct caller to create a query each and every time because you're working with an object. And finally, to point out, you can handle errors in a Java-like way here as well. GraphQL will give you a result, and if you have errors, you can throw an exception with a meaningful error here as well. Update is working the same way. You have the same base class, and just one example what you can do, you can have a build method which will take your patches, so you have patches as a map, put it in an array, so you see that they here are replaced patches you're just constructing, and again you're calling update fact sheet, and you're hiding the complexity from the caller. So within just a couple of lines, you have a fully valid example that retrieve a fact sheet by ID and update a fact sheet with some parameter, and you can build your own libraries based on this. And similar, it's working from Python. And we take a look at one concrete example, which is to edit application costs. So for Python, let's quickly start with the connection. It's similar build like in Java. So you have some JSON libraries. You have an API token and an auth URL, request URL, and those couple of lines will handle the authentication. And we have a helper method that takes a query, takes it into a JSON array, does the request, is post with GraphQL, so it has always a post, and gets the result. We have also the source code available. You can check it afterwards. So how should it look like? If you want to import a table like this, so you have a couple of applications, couple of IT components, and couple of annual costs. The main program is as easy as this. You leverage a standard Python library to read a CSV, for example, and then you do create application, create IT component, and then you loop through the CSV and create the relations. And what's really nice here is that you can use multi-line strings for Python to precisely include the GraphQL queries in a predefined way here. So it resembles exactly what you've seen in GraphQL for the mutation to create a fact sheet and also to update a fact sheet. And in the end, this query is passed to the call function, and then you leverage the nice functionality of languages like Python to process JSON. So you just step through the result tree data, create fact sheet ID, because it's directly in an array, and you can just return what you need. And as a similar example, you could also work with an update. So in this case, you have Linux IDs for the application given because you created them, for example, via Excel importer before, and also for the IT components. And again, it's the costs. And again, you read the CSV, you receive the existing relations because you assume they are there, and you update the costs. So checking how this function would look like, the getter is a bit more complex because it looks on the application and on the relation and returns the relation. So here's parsing from the result. While the update is an update fact sheet mutation, and you learned about patches, how to put them here. So it's replace. It will take the ID of the relation, which is this one, and it will provide the fact sheet ID and the cost in the value. So examples in other languages are similar, and in case of doubt, please reach out to support.linux.net. We would really encourage this because we would like to learn what ideas you have to work with GraphQL in your context, and also if something is not clear from what we have presented to you. Quick summary, we did a look at advanced concept. We talked lots about filter. I hope this was insightful, and also about patches, and we gave some examples how to embed GraphQL. The next part of the webinar will be about custom reports. So custom reports will take GraphQL as a base, but make your own JavaScript visualization available just in the UI. And this will also create nice enhancement of the standard Linux functionality to make more artifacts directly available to your users. So thanks for your attention. It's time for questions now. I'm happy to answer some. So let's wait for another second. Either it was too easy for you, which I assume, or hopefully not too complicated. We do have all the resources at devlinux.net. We will make this recording available, and please feel free to reach out to support@linux.net to get engaged. Thanks for listening today, and goodbye.